Thank you.
Governor, I have to put ethanol in my car. It fouls up my boat, it fouls up my car. It costs a lot more to make that ethanol. Yes. What's your feeling about ethanol in today's day and age?
Well, there's probably a reason that the governor of Iowa is a little upset with me right now. I don't like subsidies that go into ethanol. In fact, I don't like subsidies at all. And I think it's a budget issue in this country. And at some point, whether it's through tax reform, loopholes, biases, deductions, whether it's subsidies that get to the tens of billions of dollars, we've got to address them. And we've got to create a level playing field for people in this country. We're not there today. So just look at the subsidy per gallon. You know, we already talked about the ratcheting up to $13 when you factor in what I've already run through in the Middle East. We've got a similar situation in our subsidies for ethanol, and I think it's something that needs to be addressed. Thank you.
Mr. Ambassador, as a retired Foreign Service officer, I won't bore you with issues of foreign policy. I'll read it all in WikiLeaks. I read everything you wrote. Now, more seriously, a lot of very good words today, but one I didn't hear. Jobs. Remember the guy who won the election? It's all about the economy. I'd like you to speak for a minute about what you can do in your administration, which I would vote for, to put more Americans back to work. Thank you.
I appreciate, first and foremost, the fact that you're a retired Foreign Service officer. I've got to tell you that one of the highlights of my service overseas for the last 2 years was rubbing shoulders with men and women who were serving their country in very unique and sensitive ways. You would be very, very proud of them. The embassy in China is the second largest now in the world, and I've got to tell you, it was a truly inspiring thing to be able to work with a lot of unsung heroes who nobody will ever know about, who are doing the work of the United States overseas in pretty difficult circumstances. Jobs, for me, are rolled up in the new industrial revolution. That's what the new industrial revolution is all about. It's all about jobs, because that's exactly the bottom line of this exercise. It must be. At 9.2% unemployment, if we can't somehow hit the sweet spot in terms of job creation and the industries of tomorrow, we're going to lose. The new industrial revolution speaks to exactly that. Now, here's the thing. You know, when we talk about the new industrial revolution, we have the capital in this country. We have the innovation and the new technologies that are holed up in the pipeline. My friends in Silicon Valley are pretty plain about that. But there's no confidence in the system right now. There's no confidence in our tomorrow's economy. And so people aren't deploying capital. They're not moving their technology out to the marketplace. And because of that, jobs aren't being created. I'm here to tell you that through tax reform and getting the regulatory monkey off our back, and the 500,000 jobs, so says T. Boone Pickens, and I was the first governor to sign on to the Pickens plan. 500,000 jobs over 5 years, if we look at natural gas as an alternative fuel, I say I buy that. So everything about the new industrial revolution speaks exactly to jobs. And thank you, sir, for reminding me. We should be sprinkling that word throughout.
The question that I have is, it's my understanding at one time you were in favor of cap and trade, and then it went to say, you know what, now is not a right time for cap and trade. Can you kind of clarify when there, I don't even know if there is a right time for cap and trade, because as a conservative, I don't believe in cap and trade.
About 4 or 5 years ago, CEOs, the experts in the field of energy, were all talking about how to deal with emissions. Everybody talked about, yeah, practically every governor in America, although they might not be saying it or they might be nailed for it today, they were talking about cap and trade. It is not viable. Today, what we must do is ensure that the pathway to growth and job creation is unhindered. And that is, you know, cap and trade was left behind. I'm not sure it's ever going to be reintroduced, because we will have left it behind and technologies will be developed over time. Right now, our priority is economic expansion and jobs. Thank you. Yeah, we'll take one more and then we'll let you go.
Great. Thank you for being here today. We really appreciate it.
Thank you.
Our tax-paying citizens, notice I'm emphasizing tax-paying citizens, are burdened by and have competition for jobs, burdened by extra expenses of education, medical, healthcare, because of illegal aliens or immigrants in our country. Can you please outline your position on homeland security and a mandatory e-verify in our country, please? Thank you.
Let me start with the first step that I would take on illegal immigration. And let us not forget the part about legal immigration, which is gummed up too. Why is it that Canada is doing well economically? Why is it that the housing market in Vancouver is doing well? Probably the best housing market in the world? Legal immigration. People are buying up assets, and it's taking what were undervalued assets and moving them up in the marketplace. Now to illegal immigration. I don't think this country has any credibility at all on this subject, nor will anyone participate in the debate until we protect our border. That is the one thing that we must do. And some might say, well, how are you going to get it done? Well, it's 1,800 miles. We've done about one third of it. It's about $2 million per mile. You can fence probably most of it. You can use, I've been down on the border with National Guard troops in years past. You've got technology that can handle the other part, and you've got boots on the ground that can supplement that. And so by turning to the four border state governors, who I would say, turn to the president and tell me when your law enforcement people can verify that the border is secure. And then we'll move on with the discussion. But I'm here to tell you that there has been so much rancor and so much anger in this discussion without taking any steps at all. Let's do the fundamentals first, and let's take care of the border. E-Verify, I think it's a good thing. I think by using E-Verify through private enterprise and being able to weed out those who don't have proper documentation, ultimately, people are going to move on if they're not properly documented, and I think businesses are going to want to use it more robustly.
The governor is going to spend about 10 to 15 more minutes here and shake your hands if you'd be interested. But let's give him a big Republican Party of Sarasota. Thank you.